as you're making your way in here from the lobby. My name's Rory. I'm one of the pastors here. We want to welcome you to the third Sunday in Advent, which is a time of the year, according to the church calendar, where we look back to the first arrival of Jesus Christ and look forward in anticipation of the second arrival of Jesus Christ when he returns for us, his bride, the church. Advent is a time that is full of waiting and anticipation and desire and longing for the things of God and the promises that Christmas ultimately proves to be the fulfillment of. As we get ready for our call to worship this morning, go ahead and stand. We're going to have the pewits come on up and do the lighting of the Advent wreath. That's Jay Bird. And the words will be on the screen for this morning's scripture, which comes from Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. Read along with me. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. The fullness of time. God wastes no seconds. When he brings his promises to pass, when he sent Jesus Christ into the world to be born of Mary, to live the sinless life that he lived, to die the perfect death that he died, to be raised from that death and to ascend on high, every single thing, when it happened, happened in the perfect timing, the fullness of time. I said this last week, I'll say it again. Whatever it is that you're waiting on for the Lord to accomplish, I assure you, he's not slack with his promises. And when it comes to pass, you will look back and you will say, his timing was perfect. Pray with me. Almighty God, thank you for the opportunity, the privilege we have to worship you in spirit and in truth. And we thank you that in the fullness of time, you sent your Son into this world to be born of a woman, to fulfill the promise that was given in Genesis 3, that he would be the seed of the woman, that he would bruise, that he would crush the head of the serpent, that he would be born under the law so that he could complete the full demands of the law on our behalf, and that because of his work, we are no longer slaves, we are no longer servants, we are friends. He has called us friends. And so we will now call you Abba, Father, and worship you as sons. We thank you and we praise you now in Christ's name. Amen. Let's worship.
Come and behold him. Romans 8, 1 through 4 says, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit."
Good morning, Redemption Church. It's good to see you all here. I'm glad that you all chose to be with us this morning. I'd like to introduce myself. For those of you who don't know, my name is Joe Deeds, and me and my wife have been coming here for about 8 years now, and we recently started a small group in the Lavalette area, so if any of you are still looking for somewhere to join in, we'd love to have you, or maybe you've been here for a while and not got connected and want to get connected. See me after church. We'd love to have you. If you would, bow your heads. We'll go ahead and get started in prayer. Lord, thank you for this body of believers that has decided to come together and dedicate this time to you. I pray that we can put aside the distractions of this world, the busyness that this holiday season can create,
For some, this time is a time of joy and excitement and expectations. But for others, it's a time of heartache, grief, and dread. And I pray for those who are hurting and are in need of your comfort this morning. Remind us of Christ and how he came to us as a babe lying in a manger, a lamb that was sacrificed for the sins of this world. Store our hearts to remember that no matter where we have been or what we have done or where we have come from or where we are right now, that you are our Redeemer and took our rightful place for the punishment of our sins. Let these truths build the hope and anticipation for your second coming. No longer a babe lying in a manger, but a roaring lion, a King of kings and Lord of lords. Thank you, Lord, for your never-ending story of redemption, love, and grace. Amen.
Well, it was Emily Dickinson who wrote one of my favorite lines, "Tell all the truth, but tell it slant. The truth must dazzle gradually, or every man be blind." If you love stories, if you love communicating, and even if you love musical themes, then you probably appreciate those who tell it slant. That they don't compromise with the truth, but they understand that the truth can best be not only understood in its fullness, but received with all of the depth and emotion that is intended if you don't just come straight out to the point, but rather get there with variety, with style, even with beauty. Some of the greatest masters of literature, like Dostoevsky or Shakespeare, are able to do that. That they recognize that there's a main story that they want to get across and tell, but within that presentation, there will be inner stories that amplify one another and bring out nuance that wouldn't necessarily be seen had they chosen to do otherwise. But at the same time, holding to the unity and the depth and seriousness of what they're trying to get across. Sometimes a way to tell it slant is to do it with a context of contrast. For example, think of how many wonderful, romantic, beautiful love stories that you enjoy, either in film or again in literature, but are taking place in an environment of wartime, where there's this contrast of violence and death and chaos over against this love story and beautiful unfolding of a relationship. Same thing in music. Some of the most interesting music has within it dissonance that is surprising. It's unpredictable. If you love Handel's Messiah this time of year, which I discovered fully, I guess, last year. Some of you probably have enjoyed that every Christmas for years. You'll be struck right away, particularly if it's done excellently with a symphony orchestra, with what at times can seem chaotic. People singing different lines at the same time, and instrumentation is going all over the place, but it somehow comes together beautifully and emerges with a majesty and a grandeur that other music isn't able to accomplish. Think maybe even of your Spotify Unwrapped list that's everybody sharing out there. And think of some of your favorite artists or genre, and notice, and I bet I'm right, no matter who your artist was, that much of what you would appreciate about that style or that songwriting is their ability to get across what they're getting across in a way that is slant. Mine, I was proud to discover, was Thelonious Monk, who is known for playing in the off beats and in really a way that you would think, does this guy understand music at all, the way he plays? And if you look at his catalog, he has a number of albums, but I don't know, maybe 15 songs, but he releases the same songs in different ways over and over again. If you want homework to really get into the warpness of how much I like dissonance, look up today at some point Tom Waits and his song On the Nickel. I of the opinion, my wife would harshly disagree with me, that some of the most beautiful songs out there are communicated with people who would not traditionally be described as having beautiful voices. They're telling it slant. Okay, all of that is to bring me to the point that nobody is able to do that better than God. That your Bible is put together in a way that there is clearly a beautiful main storyline, a redemptive narrative. There is a melody, a song that God is singing about who He is and what the purpose of the world is and what's wrong with the world and how He's correcting it and what He's done to accomplish not only His glory but the joy of His people. But He weaves together hundreds of events and stories and genres and styles and circumstances to bring it all into submission to this one main storyline. That the greatest story ever told is the story of Jesus Christ. But He takes 39 books of your Bible and thousands of years before He gets to the person of Jesus Christ in His fullness of revelation that we discover and learn of in the Christmas story. Even think of the Christmas story. Jesus isn't mentioned right away. You instead are introduced to a young little Jewish couple in an insignificant, unknown town. There are shepherds, and there are at the same time kings involved in the story. There's the strength and the power of the Roman Empire, contrasted in the dissonance of lowly shepherds who are the first to hear the announcement. Caesar is thinking that he's moving all the people on the chessboard of his Roman Empire because he's sovereign. He's Augustus. When we discover that it is actually all for the purpose of getting this little couple to a place called Bethlehem in order to fulfill a promise made hundreds and hundreds of years before. Because God is a God who delights in telling it slant. Realizing that the truth, if it's going to dazzle your eyes and your heart and your mind and your soul, needs to emerge gradually. And this series that we've been going into is really a play on that, is embracing God's ability to do that. The very first chapter in the New Testament in Matthew 1 is just a list of names of seemingly insignificant, unimportant people. It is God's way of communicating with variety, with it, with style, that these are the people, or representative people for all humanity, that say to us, this is why a Savior needs to come at all. Because of sinners like these people and like us. But God's sovereign deliverance and sending of a Savior comes through these exact people and their family tree and their genealogy. And at the same time, they also become people who will be redeemed and rescued and be brought into the family. All of that is happening in what, frankly, is a boring, uninteresting, like reading the phone book style. And so what we're doing this month, and we'll conclude next week with the last individual biography that we look at in the person of Mary, Jesus' mother, is we're choosing some of the unexpected people in that list, the matriarchs of God's Savior, His ancestors, those courageous, godly, beautiful, dignified women that, while not perfect, were people that God wonderfully chooses to tell His story of redemption. And out of that list emerges for us, in our consideration, the balance of my time, a woman who
comes from nothing. Her name is Ruth, and she is out of step with her times. She doesn't fit situationally, because the times in which she lived and we read of her are extremely hard and difficult times. And she shines like a bright light out of that darkness as a woman of dignity and beauty and purity and integrity. And even though she's living in a context of poverty and death and isolation, she gets caught up in one of the most beautiful love stories in your Bible. It was a time, and chronologically, even in the unfolding of God's story, even in the placement of where the book of Ruth finds itself in your Bible, it's a book and a story that seems to be offbeat. It's out of line with what you expect. The book right before Ruth is Judges. The book right after Ruth is 1 Samuel. Both books tell of times of war and death and chaos, compromised leadership, marked and characterized by God's people deciding they don't want to do things God's way, they want to do things their way. And right in the middle of that, we get this quiet interlude of love and simple faith. And it's a story that is so needed in our times that we would also probably mark off as a time of moral depravity, a time of a lack of commitment to biblical teaching, a time where men and women decide they want to self-actualize in their own identity of self, that they'll do things their way and they'll be who they want to be, with no understanding or joy in deciding who God has called them to be. And we so need to be like Ruth and encouraged by Ruth, voices of hope. Voices and witnesses and lifestyles of God's people saying that there's still a remnant of God's mission and God's message and God's model. So that the world, regardless of nationality, regardless of environment, can be dazzled by the truth of Jesus Christ. I'm looking in the faces of some of you and people that, frankly, when I was putting my thoughts together for this talk, I thought of, who remind me of Ruth. I won't name you because you're the type that it would embarrass if I did, but your personality is shy. You're introverted. You're quiet. You sort of resist the limelight. And there's everything beautiful and right about that, that God has made you that way and you embrace it. But you are making a significant impact and you are making a difference and adding beauty and depth to this church and to God's mission. So turn with me, if you haven't already, to the book of Ruth. As I said, it comes on the heels, not surprising, of the last verse of the book of Judges. In case you want to know, what is this moment in history in which Ruth emerges? We read in Judges 21, verse 25, "In those days there was no king in Israel, and everyone did what was right in his own eyes." Again, sounds like today. And on that backdrop of moral depravity, Ruth sparkles like a diamond. Like the dark black night sky, she's like a shooting star that emerges out of nowhere, shines brightly, catches your attention, causes you to lean in. And just about when you get a great picture of what you're dealing with, she vanishes off the scene. Even in her own book, four other people are mentioned before her name is even brought up. And even when her story wraps up in chapter 4, the emphasis quickly shifts to King David and her connection to his grand, famous, more sensational life. And she's mentioned nowhere else in the scriptures after her book until, as I already said, in Matthew chapter 1 in a list of names. The story starts in verse 1, just like Judges ends in the days when the judges ruled. Again, a time of spiritual depression. There was also a time of economic depression. There was a famine in the land. And so naturally, people would begin to have to move in order to provide for themselves and find food. And it's in this meta time of spiritual depression and economic depression that the lens of the Spirit Scripture sort of zooms in on this unknown and small little family. There was a man in Bethlehem in Judah who went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and the name of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion, and they were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah, and they went into the country of Moab and remained there. That would be what we today would call Jordan. That's where Moab is. So Jews in a Palestinian country. And they find relief, they find work when tragedy strikes. Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her two sons. And left with that loss, about a decade of time passes, and in that decade, those two sons move through their loss, and they take wives. They took Moabite wives. The name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other, and here's our heroine, Ruth. And they lived there about 10 years. When again, tragedy lands after a decade of peace and rest. When both Mahlon and Chilion died. I don't know if they happened to die together or isolated, but over the course of that 10 years they die, so that the woman was left without her two sons and her husbands. So these three women are left alone and shattered emotionally, scared of how they would provide for themselves, how they would be protected. Additionally, the warmth and the companionship of love and the people in their life. J. Sidlow Baxter writes, "In seeking a livelihood, they were bereft of life. In seeking bread, they found graves." And it's a heartbreaking scene. You can feel some of the depth of that. And they experienced what I would think is an extraordinary amount of loss there. Very few people that I know have lost a spouse in their younger years, as well as children, or a child even, much less multiple children. I was best friends with a fella in my late elementary years and junior high years and early part of high school years. I mean, we were just as close as you could possibly be. And toward the end of his high school years, got caught up in drugs and a lifestyle, and we sort of separated. But in our late teens and early 20s, his older brother, who was a couple of years older than him, died of cancer. And then he died of a drug overdose. And his sister, who was between him and my buddy and his older brother, also got caught up in drug addiction and had children. And the grandparents, the parents of my friend, who had lost two sons and had a daughter who was estranged from them and caught up in all of the pain and consequences of addiction, now had grandchildren that they were raising. And after a number of years, the father died unexpectedly at a Marshall football game of a heart attack. And here is this woman now in her, I think, 70s, who's lost a husband, who has lost two sons, and who is raising these grandkids. And this is what they're experiencing. They're reeling. And it's easy for you to to feel in times like that, where's God? To feel abandoned in your pain, you naturally think that. That when life knocks your legs out from underneath you, that you question, is God near? Is he present? Does he care? Well, we never need to doubt. We might feel that way, but God actually tells us that he's nearest in those times. Psalm 34 says, God is near to the brokenhearted and rescues those whose spirit is crushed. That when you hurt the most, that is God is near you the most. You could say it that way. Now notice Ruth's reaction to her loss. She's a rare woman who doubles down on commitment and relationship. I got to tell you, if I'd lost that, and I've lost some in my life, the relationships, nothing like this, my tendency would be to get a little gun-shy about letting people too close, that I'd become distant, keep people at arm's length. Ruth doesn't do that. She actually realizes, and don't forget, she's lost a husband. But rather than fall into a victimhood of self-pity, she decides, I'm going to take on the role of encourager. I'm going to be close to my mother-in-law. You see that in verse 14 of chapter 1. They lifted up their voices and they wept. And Orpah, Ruth's sister-in-law, and Naomi's daughter-in-law, kissed her mother-in-law. And I take it meaning as a kissed her goodbye. She's going to return back to Moab. But Ruth clung to Naomi. She stuck there. And she said, Naomi said, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return, just like your sister-in-law has. But Ruth said, no, don't urge me to leave you or to return from following you. For where you go, I will go. And where you lodge, I will lodge. And your people shall be my people. And your God, my God. And where you die, I will die. And there will I be buried. May the Lord do so to me and more. Also, if anything but death parts me from you. And Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, and she yielded. It's a great commitment. You can't say it any stronger than that. Don't, again, overlook the risk that Ruth is taking there. She's a Palestinian. She's not Jewish. And yet she's committed to this friendship and this God that she has now adopted as her own, that she's willing to take the risk to go into an unfamiliar country, a language that she doesn't speak, a culture she doesn't understand, likely being viewed with suspicion by that culture. Tensions then were as tense as they are now between Palestinians and Jews. And yet she's going to stay close. Probably, you know, Naomi mentions this in verse 8 and 9 of chapter 1. It would mean, at least humanly speaking, that there's no chance of her getting married. She's still in her childbearing years. She still, I'm sure, wants companionship and love and romance. And Jews don't marry Moabites, not in Judah. And so she is so committed in her sacrificial generosity to others and her faith in this newfound God that she's willing to do it. And talk about telling it slant. How out of step does this story seem to our culture in which mother-in-laws and daughter-in-laws are best friends and close, right? I mean, after all, what do you do when you miss your mother-in-law? You shoot again. No. Not Ruth. She's not like that. See, she loves her mother-in-law. And they're close. Now look at her response to loneliness. She knows no one in town. And she, chapter 2, verse 1, she realizes that Naomi had a relative of her husband's, a worthy man of the clan of Elimelech, whose name was Boaz, but she doesn't know that yet. That's for the reader. But Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, let me go to the field. They go back to, in verse 19, look where they go. The two of them went on until they came to Bethlehem. So they're there, and I guess the famine's gone. It's been over a decade, and Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, let me go to the field and glean among the ears of grain after him, in whose sight I shall find favor. So she goes back to work in the loss. I did that when my stepfather died, one of the closest people in my life. Died on a Friday, I preached on Sunday. Many of my family kind of urged, you need to take some time, it's acceptable, and many of you reached out to give me that. That wouldn't have helped me. I need to get back to work. I didn't want to be sitting around. And that's helpful if you do that. I take it Ruth is similar to me in that way. And that, let's get busy. Let's get the focus off of my feelings and serve and give toward others. And she does that. Now from here on, the three main people in the story are going to be Ruth, Naomi, and Boaz. And Boaz is a man that Ruth doesn't know, but God has had planned for him and Ruth to come into contact all along. And if you love romantic stories, this is one of the best in your Bible. This is better than any Christmas Hallmark story you're gonna find. So she goes into this field to glean among the ears of grain after a man that she might find favor with. If you know your Old Testament, you know that the Jewish people were commanded in the law to not only get specified lots of land, and that was distributed by clans within the tribes, and that was to be guarded and maintained, but God said that when you work your field, don't glean, harvest the edges of your field. And as you're harvesting, if anything drops on the ground, don't pick it up but leave it. And if you miss any parts of the harvest in the first working through the field, don't go back. And that sort of served as a national welfare system for anybody who didn't have land or food that they could come and sort of just take what was left after the harvest, and that could serve as their food. And so she's impoverished. She doesn't own property but she's probably not able to work it because her husbands and her father-in-law have died. And so she goes out to the field to do that. In verse 3, she set out and went and gleaned in the field after the reapers, and she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the clan Elimelech. That was her father-in-law. So this is, specifically, this is his nephew. And she doesn't know that. It says, it happened. She didn't go there because of that. It literally, in Hebrew, it's, she chanced upon a chance to happen to be gleaning in the Boaz's field. That we would say it was serendipity. It was luck. It was chance. She happened to be in the right place at the right time. And not only that, but Boaz happened to be there overseeing the work. Behold, Boaz, verse 4, came from Bethlehem, and he said to the reapers, "The Lord be with you." And they answered, "The Lord bless you." So the first thing we learn about Boaz is he's a man who's marked by his faith. He speaks boldly of his faith. The people he works with know he is a person of faith. And this is the main point of this sermon or the story, but if you're single here this morning or you're a teenager, pay attention. While the cultural norms of what is about to unfold are going to feel weird and strange to our 21st century American ears, this is a master class on how to pursue godly relationships. And the first thing we learn about Boaz right there is he is a godly man. But one thing that I love about him is just because he's a spiritual godly man doesn't mean that he is not a hot-blooded Jewish male who's single. He is also attracted to women. Good for him. You can do that, right? Don't be so caught up in your Bible study and being godly that you become weird and not necessarily want to, you know, recognize when there's a pretty girl in the room, guys, okay? And so that's what I read him say in verse 5. Boaz said to his young man who was in charge of the reapers, "Now whose young woman is this?" I'm reading a little hormones in that "whose young woman is this." He sees her gleaning the field, and I don't know, however you're gleaning, and he sees that she's physically attractive. He doesn't know anything about her. All he knows is that she's attractive. He sees her. And the servant who was in charge of the reapers answered. He doesn't answer. She's really attractive. He says she's the young Moabite woman who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab. And she came to me. She took initiative. She's assertive. She said, "Please let me glean and gather among the sheaves after the reapers." And so she came, and she's continued from early morning until now, except for a short rest. So she's hardworking. She's assertive. She's a servant hearted person. She is sacrificial and committed to her family and her mother-in-law. And we're going to find out later that she's also a godly woman. So when you're It's okay. Whenever I teach dating, I always say this because Christians somehow seem ashamed to say this. It's okay that the first thing that you're attracted to in another person is their physical traits. God made you to be that way, and that's okay. It just can't stay there. You need to find out what kind of character they have. I've often said to folks, it's okay that you want to date a hunk, but you need to find out a hunk of what is he, right? She might be hot, but so is hell, right? So you don't want that kind of hot. You need to find out it's the good kind. And so you have a man here who is not only physically attracted, but spiritually attracted. And this servant rightly points to her character. Now watch Boaz initiate. He wants to initiate the context in which he gets to know her. He's defining the relationship, we might say. He's setting out expectations of what she should expect from him and what he's looking for as they pursue one another. Boaz said to Ruth, "Now listen, my daughter, don't go to glean in another field or leave this one, but keep close to my young women. Live your life accountably. I want to spend time with you. I want there to be sort of a community aspect to our relationship. Let your eyes be on the field that they are reaping and go after them. And I have charged the young men not to touch you. So I'll provide some protection over you. And when you're thirsty, go to the vessels and drink what the young men have drawn." What's he doing there? He is demonstrating to her that time needs to be taken to spend together with one another so that we can get to know one another. And in that, you're going to see that I'm able to provide for a home as a man. I'm able to protect a wife. I'm able to initiate and lead in the relationship. And so he pursues that. Now, he sets up the time for that character to be tested, and that's what we ought to be looking for. And look at Ruth's response in verse 10, and it's full of humility and grace, right? And guys, this is the kind of thing you want to look for in a wife. See how it goes in verse 10? She fell on her face and bowed to the ground. No, that's a joke. That's a joke. Don't kill me. She is humbly positioning herself under that, submitting to that plan. "Why have I found favor in your eyes that you should take notice of me? I'm a foreigner." But Boaz answered, "You want to know why I noticed you? It wasn't because you were pretty, although that was a part of it. The thing that most marked you out as interesting to me is all that you've done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has been fully told to me, and how you left your father and mother in your native land and came to a people that you didn't know. The Lord repay you for what you've done, and a full reward be given you by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. I notice that you are a person who sacrificially gives to others, and rather than find your rest and your identity in your beauty or your culture or your circumstances, you find your identity as one who has taken refuge under the wings of Yahweh God." It's wonderful. And don't doubt, those of you who are looking for a spouse, that is the most important thing you should find. By God's grace, you will get old and fat. He will prosper you, and you will know, you will. The longer you're living together, the less attractive we're all going to get, right? That's just how it goes, and that's okay. And on top of that, there will come loss through life. There will become adversity. There will at times perhaps be sickness. There will be economic pressure. It will be your character and your faith that will keep you together, that will keep you committed. And so Ruth has quite the reputation. And she said, "I found favor in your eyes, my Lord, for you have comforted me and spoken kindly to your servant, though I'm not one of your servants." So he's sacrificial and generous and gracious as well. Now look at verse 19. Back at the ranch, dinner that night, her and Naomi are talking it over, and her mother-in-law said, "Where'd you glean today? Where'd you work? Blessed be the man who took notice of you." So she told her mother-in-law with whom she'd worked that day, and said, "This man's name with whom I work today is Boaz." Again, Ruth's never read Ruth at this point. She doesn't know Boaz from Bozo, and so he's just some guy who let me work the welfare system you guys have in Bethlehem. But Naomi chokes on her food because she knows exactly who that is. Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, "May he be blessed by the Lord whose kindness has not forsaken the living or the dead." Naomi also said to her, "The man is a close relative of ours. He's one of our redeemers, Ruth." And Ruth's looking at Naomi the way you're looking at me. So what? What does that mean? Well, you've got to understand the Jewish concept of redeemers. Again, it's connected to this whole concept of the land and the provision that God has given. And he wants to make sure that whoever got the land in that tribe, that land stays in that land, in that tribe. And so Elimelech and Judah, they've got land. And so if Ruth's husband dies, it's now in Moabite hands. Unless, and the law prescribed for this, a kinsman, a relative within that same tribe could step into the role of what was called a kinsman redeemer and do a couple of things. If there was any wrongs that needed avenged, that kinsman redeemer was on the hook to do it. Second, he was to manage that estate and make sure it was prosperous and being lived out the way it was intended, and that the people within that that clan were taken care of. And third, he had the right to marry the widow if they so chose. And so Naomi is saying Boaz is a redeemer. He could do this. So she's clearly saying that God is opening doors. God is sovereignly bringing into place all of these things that could work in our favor. But just because God can bring a Ruth or a Boaz into our life at any point, it doesn't mean that there shouldn't be some wise, strategic, humanly speaking, resourcefulness that we can take advantage of to pursue what we feel God's called us to and what we desire. And so that's what happens in chapter 3, verse 1. Naomi, fully in submission to God's sovereignty and plan, but being the leader in the home, like we should, parents, teaching our children how to date, how to pursue relationships, she does that. She says, "My daughter, should I not seek rest for you that it may be well with you? I'm doing this for your good. Is not Boaz our relative with whose young women you were? So here's what I want you to do. I want you to wash and anoint yourself. You looked a little shabby the last time you went, so clean up a little bit now that we know Boaz is there and you're going to be seeing one another. Make sure you don't stink. Anoint yourself, put on some deodorant and perfume, and put on your cloak. Be dressed a little nicer. Nothing wrong with that. And go down to the threshing floor. And don't make yourself known to the man until he's finished eating and drinking." I read that and I thought, what is he, like a dog? He's going to bite you if you talk to him, try to touch him while he's eating. No. I think some of that's strategic. You're going to see here in a minute. His heart is merry with wine. I don't think he's getting drunk. That would lack integrity. Boaz seems to be a man of integrity, but he's a little more in the romantic mood, maybe after a glass, and so let him do that and be in a little receptive place. And again, as weird as this is culturally, this is a wonderful model for how to pursue relationships. See how it says in verse 4, look at this strange plan. When he lies down, so you're going to be there, I guess they do this at night, this is sort of a night shift gleaning job, observe the place where he lies, then go and uncover his feet and lie down and he will tell you what to do. And she said, all right, all that you say I'll do. So she went down to the threshing floor and did just as her mother-in-law had commanded her. And when Boaz had eaten and drunk and his heart was merry, he went to lie down at the end of the heap of grain. And she came softly and uncovered his feet and lay down. Now that could sound a little kinky in our 21st century American day, but it wasn't then. This was all a symbolic sort of communicating with one another about where we're at, where we stand in relationship. Apparently, it's still done to this day in some parts of the world. And so while there is sexual innuendo in the Old Testament of someone having their feet uncovered, right, it's basically uncovering the lower part of a person, it wasn't immorality here. It was symbolic. It was saying, what she's saying here, and Boaz would have understood, is I am taking this shawl over you that warms you, covers the intimate parts of your body, that protects you from the elements. I'm removing that from you, it's yours, and I'm placing it on me to say to you, I want that from you. I want you to step into the role of provider, protector, intimate, close friend. And so that's all going on in this. And it's perfectly balanced. In verse 8, at midnight, the man was startled and turned over, and behold, a woman lay at his feet. He said, "Who are you?" She answered, "I'm Ruth, your servant." See, spread your wings over your servant, for you are a redeemer. So she's responsive, but she's trusting in God's sovereignty. She's desiring intimacy, but she's waiting on the right context and the right approach to which to get it. Nothing is forced. Nothing is passive either. Both are interested. Now look at verse 10. Now this could seem like bad news. He said, "May you be blessed by the Lord, my daughter." So he's clearly picking up what she's laying down. "You've made this last kindness greater than the first, in that you've not gone after young men, whether poor or rich." I take it maybe he's older. There's better looking guys than me. There's richer guys than me. "But instead you have chosen me because of my integrity and my character. So now, my daughter, don't fear. I will do for you what you ask. I will pursue you in marriage, for all my fellow townsmen know that you're a worthy woman." That's why her reputation precedes her. "And it is true that I am a redeemer, yet there is a redeemer nearer than I." Bad news. Her heart must have sunk when she heard that. What if he's, you know, broke? What if he's ugly? What if he's mean? But he says, "Well, remain tonight. In the morning, if he'll redeem you, good. Let him do it. But if not, if he's not willing to redeem you, as the Lord lives, I will redeem you. So lie down until the morning. Rest in God's sovereignty. Rest in my leadership. I'm going to pursue this. We've got to do this the right way. We can't do an end around God's plan. And so we've got to approach this biblically. We've got to do it well. And it takes confidence in God's sovereignty to do that." And so in chapter 4, I won't read it. We can speed it up. But he goes to the elders. He for accountability, for leadership, he explains what's going on. He goes to the other guy who's a closer relative and has the right to redeem the property and marry Ruth. But when he explains all that's going on, the guy decides, "Well, it's to complicate my own inheritance, and I'm not interested." And so it falls to Boaz in verse 6. The Redeemer said, "I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I impair my own inheritance. Take my right of redemption yourself, for I cannot redeem it." And Boaz wastes no time. In verse 13, Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife, and he went into her, and the Lord gave her conception, and she bore a son. And then the woman said to Naomi, "Blessed be the Lord, who has not left you this day without a redeemer. May his name be renowned in Israel." Verse 17, "And the women of the neighborhood gave him a name, saying, 'A son has been born to Naomi.' And they named him Obed. He was the father of Jesse, the father of David." She has what will become the grandfather of David. A Moabite. A Palestinian. And how about this for a little gem? We last week looked at Rahab. Guess who Boaz's mom is? Rahab. Rahab comes back into the Israel to the community of faith. Tradition says she actually married one of the spies named Salmon, and they have a son named Boaz. So that's how it all ties together. And the rest of that, verse 18, is almost literally cut and pasted into Matthew chapter 1. This wonderful counter melody, this inner story, this seemingly insignificant Moabite woman is telling its slant to say to you and I a couple of three things, and I'll end on these. First, and this connects to the main melody, God is still near to the brokenhearted. When Jesus comes onto the scene as the Redeemer. Boaz is a type to the archetype, Jesus, who will come and redeem his people from their sins, who will adopt us into his family, who will give us rights and privileges, not that we deserve, but he becomes for us what we could never become. He does for us what we could never do, gains for us what we could never earn, or bring about. He lives the perfect life. He dies on the cross as a substitute, and he's raised from the dead, and now offers everything that he has and says, you will be co-heirs with me. You will be sons and daughters of God, and his name will be renowned in Israel. And he does that for the people who are brokenhearted. He rescues those of us who are crushed in spirit. Second, God is still sovereignly protecting the lonely. I don't know if you've noticed it before, but the first people to get the announcement that unto us a son is given are those shepherds. They are those who would be outcasts of society. They would be the people that were gleaning the edges of the fields. They were the people who were uneducated, who were ceremonially unclean because of their work. And God tells it slant, and that when Christ is born, the angel goes first to the lonely and the isolated and says, unto you a son has been given. And finally, God is still redeeming sinners as his own. He's saying, I'll take Rahab, the prostitute. I'll take Ruth, the Moabite. I'll take whosoever will. I'm redeeming them. I'm purchasing them. That's what redemption is. Remember when you were a little kid, especially if you lived around here, one of the places you'd go is Billy Bob's Pizza Palace down in Barbersville. And you'd go in to play all the games and get the tickets. They have receipts now. But when I was a boy, they had tickets. And you'd play skee ball or you'd try to whack the moles or whatever it was. And however good you did, they'd spit out all these tickets. And you'd get all of them in the pile on your arm when you were done. And you'd go up to that counter and you'd look at all those ghetto toys they have up there, of the kazoo or the spider ring or the paddle ball, you know, you'd play until it broke, and then it turned into something your parents would spank you with, and trash, just cheapo, unwanted toys. And you'd spend, you know, $30 to get enough tickets to get some of that garbage. On those tickets, I remember that it would say, redeem. And you would go to that counter and redeem with these tickets what you wanted. Christmas says to us that God is bringing the infinitely valuable blood of Jesus Christ. It has now been provided to satisfy the wrath of God, and God the Father is sovereignly choosing who he will out from among the world to be brought into his family. Christmas says not just to Naomi, not just to Ruth, not just to shepherds, not just to Mary and Joseph, not just to Jews, but Palestinians and Americans and men and women and all the lives represented in this room. God wants you. He loves you. Not because there's anything inherently valuable in it, but because he wants you. The same way a kid just wants the spider. Why? Because. Just because. If you've never come to him, what a great time of year to come to a Redeemer. Good, bow your heads, please, as we close in prayer and begin to move into a time of communion. If you've never received Jesus as your Savior and your Redeemer, he is the one who you must come to. And why not do that now? The Son of the Father who came to buy us back from the slavery of sin, even though we're broken, lost, sinful, rebellious, confused, and trying to make it now, or trying to make it on our own, is now saying to you, I'm near. I'm close. I am God. Jesus is saying, God with us. Father, we thank you for the delight and charm of your counter melodies. They bring a variety and a uniqueness that helps us understand the story of your Son in a beautiful and nuanced way. It's in stories like these that we appreciate him in a depth, in a greatness that we otherwise wouldn't. We see our weakness and our need, but at the same time, we see your grace and mercy and love. And it's in the name of Christ, the Redeemer, we pray. Amen. Those of you who are taking communion, go ahead and find your way forward, please, and grab the elements that are representatives of the body and blood of Christ. A plate of crackers and some cups of juice. Those of you who are familiar with us at Redemption Church know we do this every week. If you're new, this is something that we do in obedience to Jesus' command that as we gather to remember his body and blood, that there's something about the tangible handling of the elements that tells its slant. That this spiritual reality of Christ dying for us can physically be received in faith as we eat that cracker and drink that juice. Saying in essence, God, we believe that Jesus is God. We believe that he is a Savior. And we have not only taken him once by faith, but we continue in an ongoing way, keep on believing the message of the gospel that we've heard. So as these pass, simply, if you've trusted Christ and have been baptized in the body of Christ, you take those elements and pass them along, proclaiming the gospel to one another. This is Christ's body broken for you. This is Christ's blood shed for you. Enjoy it.
Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. What an incredible, incredible story this is that we believe this morning, that an earthly Redeemer would be the means by which the heavenly Redeemer was born to us at Christmas. And it's not just a story, it's true. It happened. And with all our hearts and one accord, we believe it. And so, with that in mind, we got a few announcements. Next Sunday, Christmas Eve, we will not be having our evening service. We're going to have a Sunday morning gathering. Come early at 9:45 for breakfast, and that's going to be a family-friendly service, so bring your kiddos. There is going to be the nursery open for a cry room, and then we're also going to be having Sunday morning gathering on December 31st, as normal, at 10:30 a.m. and all that. And then, of course, there's some Christmas ornaments out there. I got mine. It's pretty. Go get yours, and don't leave before you get those. They're out at the Connect desk. All right, and if you're new, looking to connect in any way, feel free to take one of those Connect cards on the seat backs in front of you, fill that out, drop it either in the give boxes or take it to the Connect desk. We got another gift in addition to the ornament that you'll be getting. All right, stretch out your hands, receive this benediction. Now may the Lord Jesus, the truer and better kinsman redeemer, be the source of our joy and the delight of our souls. May we see the price of our redemption that he has paid and the freedom from sin that he has accomplished give you peace and happiness this season. Go now from this place, knowing your Redeemer lives and will one day return for us his bride. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all Redemption Church together said, Amen.